Welcome back. This is part two of my new battery cell monitor design. At the end of the last video, I was going away to fix a few issues and get a new prototype ordered. And here it is. This new board is a four-layer PCB, which has allowed me to shrink the design by a significant amount. I mentioned in my previous video that a lot of people now use active balancers, so I've decided to remove the passive balancing circuit from this board and make it an add-on instead. This reduces the cost for people who don't want that functionality. I'll show you how that works later in this video. Talking of saving costs, I normally order my prototypes from JLC PCB in a partially assembled state, and then hand solder the remaining parts as needed. This ensures I don't end up with lots of boards with possible faulty designs, but does give me a bit of a headache on the soldering. I really don't recommend soldering this new board by hand. It takes a lot of patience, hot air, and a microscope. Ultimately, JLC will solder the entire board once I have a known working design. Normally, I start by constructing modular parts of the circuit, for example, the power supply or the microcontroller. I can then power up each section and test the voltages are correct. This prevents me from blowing up expensive chips due to a bad design on my behalf. I made a bit of a mess of the soldering on some of these small chips, but managed to clean them all up in the end. I couldn't do this without the microscope. The pins are absolutely tiny. For the larger chip, I used hot air and solder paste to lock the corner of the chip in place. Then went around with a soldering iron and some flux. In the previous video, I received a lot of comments about limiting this board to only LFP cell voltages, which were around 3.6 volts. I've since then made a U-turn on that decision. So this design now supports both 4 and 4.5 volt reference chips, so standard lithium cell voltages can be measured using this design. Here's a complete prototype board for version number 2. Unfortunately, there are still two mistakes on this board. I got the wrong pin out on the MOSFET, so that needed to be rotated, and I also messed up the enable pin on the max chip. These have now been fixed on prototype number 3, which is here. JLC PCB must be making a nice profit out of me this month. Now, one of the problems with this board is actually the cost. As you only need a single board to monitor 16 cells, JLC will normally require you to order 5 as a minimum. Once I'm fully happy with the design, I will try and set up a shop for purchasing single boards. I mentioned that the passive cell balancer has been moved to a separate PCB. This simply plugs onto the top of the monitoring board. This modular design means lower costs for people not requiring this functionality. I'm using a 200 milliamp balancing current for each of these cells. One of the problems of such a small PCB is the heat this would generate if all the cells are balancing at the same time. Therefore, I've allowed 2 screw holes to mount a heatsink. I've struggled to find a cost-effective heatsink of the correct dimensions. So here I'm using a solid piece of aluminium bar. After cutting down to the correct size, I drill mounting holes and holes to mount a 12 volt fan. These screws are tapped into the block of aluminium. This BMS design now has active cooling with a temperature controlled fan. I place some Kapton tape between the board and the heatsink to prevent any short circuits, and plastic screws and nuts to fix it in place. Now, the hardware design is only part of the story. I've had to write hundreds of lines of code to support this new design, along with code changes to the user interface on the controller to add some new features. Before I dive into the details, a reminder that this is still a work in progress and I'm expecting lots of bugs and problems. Here we have the familiar DIYBMS web interface. I've noticed a few people haven't realised you can add and remove the tiles on the homepage. To do this, click on the tiles menu option. Any of the tiles which have a dotted outline will be shown on the home screen. Just click on a tile to toggle this feature. You can also click on the tiles on the home page to actually hide them. I've got three external temperature sensors connected to this new board. There is also an onboard temperature sensor. These values are reported alongside cells 0 to 3. Any more than 4 cells are reported without a temperature. If the balance board is fitted, there are also 2 additional sensors on that for monitoring overheat of the balance resistors. Those temperatures appear against all the cells in the pack. If we click into the modules page, we can see the 4 cells connected to the all-in-one board. The identify button doesn't do anything with the all-in-one board. The single cell boards should light up the LED, but I am aware of a bug in that feature at the moment. If we click the configure button on module 3, you can see that we can't change anything. It's all read-only. Module 2 and 1 are the same. This is because the all-in-one board has a single set of configuration values, and those are configured from the first cell connected to the board. On module 0, the settings become editable. The all-in-one board is identified as version 4.9. The newer settings shown are only visible if you are using this board. We have the usual bypass temperature and bypass threshold settings. These are only applicable if you have the passive balance board fitted. Next is the calibration value. This is hard-coded to number 1 for these boards. There shouldn't be any need for calibration given the accuracy of the components we're using. The analog front-end chip used in the all-in-one board has a built-in calibration function which runs when the board is first powered up. The parasite voltage is a read-only value calculated by the chip and is used by the software for more accurate voltage readings. Next up is the temperature at which the fan will spin up. The fan will continue to spin until the temperature falls below this value. Once that happens, the fan continues to run for another minute to prevent the fan switching on and off rapidly. Again, this is only applicable if you've got the balance board. You can use both passive and active balancer boards at the same time. There is a relay output to control an active balancer, and these two values determine at what point the relay is activated. You can specify a minimum voltage and a minimum voltage range. That's the difference between the lowest and highest cell voltages in that bank. So in this example, the relay would be activated when any one cell goes over 3.4 volts, and the difference between the cell voltages is greater than 5 millivolts. Once the relay is activated, it stays switched on for at least 1 minute, even if those conditions are no longer met. We also have a brand new feature, which is only available on these new all-in-one boards. I've called this feature Cell Runaway. Again, you can specify a voltage and a range. What this feature does is to look at the average cell voltages across the whole bank. Should any one cell exceed that voltage by the different setting, passive balancing is started on that cell. This helps to balance a pack quicker, as the cells don't have to reach the threshold voltage before balancing begins. It helps to deal with a situation where one cell is charging quicker than the others. Now I've decided to take the bold decision to release the new design and code in its current state. I'm keeping these files in a separate branch in GitHub. Details are on the screen. Now a word of warning, I'm classing this design as a prototype. So if you do decide to build one, I can't guarantee it's completely free from hardware design problems or software bugs. It shouldn't blow up in your face, but I can't guarantee it. Hopefully, software bugs can be fixed, but hardware designs might require bodge wires or even an entirely new PCB. So please be warned. I've added a README file to the branch, so please take time to read through that. There's one in the software and the hardware folders. It will save you both time and money and prevent you from ordering the wrong parts. If you want to follow along in this new design, please consider subscribing to this YouTube channel. It's free and only takes a single click. Thanks for watching.